In the last video, we mapped out the skills that you need for two different goals. Number one, becoming an iOS developer to find a job. And number two, becoming an iOS developer to build your own apps. I even made a downloadable PDF for you with the skill trees. Now we need to talk about finding the right resources to learn these skills. So, where do you find the proper learning resources? Well, the answer has two parts. Number one, where do you find the learning resources? This is the easy part. Number two, and this is the hard part, how do you judge if it's right for you? And for this, I have seven criteria to look for. But before we dive into that, let's cover the easy part first. Where do you find these resources? And this depends on what is the best mode of learning for you. If you like in-person learning, look for some in-person classes or an in-person course in your city. If you like reading, search on Google for your topic or go to the library. If you like video, search on YouTube. Now, if you're doing in-person learning, I'm sure the quality is going to be there and the training is going to be up to date. And more importantly, the concepts taught are going to be taught in the right order and progression so that you build up your skills. Same thing with a book. The only thing I'd check is the publication date, because technology changes so fast, you'll want to make sure the book was published within the last 12 months, ideally. Now, if instead you found an article on Google or a video on YouTube, then I'd suggest running through the following seven criteria. Number one, is it for beginners? If you are a beginner, then I would recommend that you search for an article or video that has the term for beginners, starting from scratch, or something like that. The reason is because these learning resources will focus on using less technical jargon and explain things at a slower pace. Number two, what does the resource cover? If it's your first time learning about a topic, then your goal should be to find a resource that gives you an overview of the topic before deep diving into anything specific. For example, if you're learning Xcode and you find an article on all the features and things that you can do with the editor area, that's not very helpful if you don't even know what the editor area is. Ideally, you're looking for an overview of Xcode before even getting into the details. Number three, is it up to date or is it still relevant? It's extremely tough to learn from an outdated resource because as you're trying to follow along, you're going to hit road bumps and you may not be able to follow along at all. And this just adds to the frustration of learning. So how do you determine if the resource is up to date? First of all, you need to find out what is the latest version of Xcode or Swift or whatever the topic is that you're trying to learn. And that can be done with a quick Google search. Number two, does the resource have some sort of indication about what version it's compatible for? If not, then you may want to consider leaving a comment or checking the comments or messaging the author to see if there's any information you can find out. You can ask the author, does this resource still work for this latest version of that topic? Now, one thing to keep in mind is that things may not have changed that much in the latest version compared to the previous version. So a good quality learning resource may still be a great resource for you to learn on. For this, I would check the comments of the article or video and see if people are still using this to learn today. Number four, is it a series? Now this is a bonus. I love the series format because it breaks down a bigger topic into bite-sized lessons. And what's more is that each lesson can build upon the last and it allows the student or the viewer to feel progression in skills. Now again, this is a bonus if your learning resource is broken up into a series of articles or videos, but it's not an absolute requirement. Number five, does it have a table of contents? Again, this is a bonus and it's very easy and quick to see. If there is a table of contents, that means that the author has given some thought into the order in which the ideas should be presented in. And I think that is an easy way to tell if it's a quality resource or not. It is not a red flag if it's missing. Again, it's just a bonus if it is there. Number six, does it have some steps to follow along or something to practice on? So for example, if there are steps that you can see in the learning resource, then that is something that you can try to replicate on your own computer and try to follow along. And this is super duper important because I don't know how long you've been following, but my story in learning iOS is that I failed for the first time simply because I did not do enough practicing as I was learning. I read a book from cover to cover, thought I knew everything, I understood everything, but when I sat down to try to build an app, I realized that I didn't know how to start and I kind of had to start all over in my learning process. So that's why I highly recommend that you follow along and practice and make this a very big component of your learning journey. And this leads me to my seventh criteria, which is more of a learning tip for you actually. And that is to let your practice guide you in your learning. What do I mean by that? It means that when you find a learning resource, treat it as a starting point, right? Follow along and practice it. As you practice, the beautiful thing is that questions will come up. You're going to discover what you don't know, and you're going to have questions pop up in your head. What about this? What about that? That the learning resource may not have covered. So let those questions guide you in searching for the answers to those questions. And that is a great way to explore and learn a topic. I guess another way to phrase this tip is that the learning resource that you initially find, it doesn't need to be super comprehensive and cover everything about that topic. In fact, it might be kind of hard to find a learning resource that does that. You'll probably take several learning resources to fully cover the topic. And the important thing is that you find a good starting point, right? You start practicing it so that you generate those questions and you generate and you find out what you don't know. And then you let those questions guide you in searching for answers, right? And that is also a very practical way to learn. So when we create training material here at Code with Chris, our video courses or series, we always try to keep these things in mind. Even this How to Become an iOS Developer series that you're watching right now is an example of that. These days, there are so many different learning resources out there that are completely free. If you really want to achieve your goal, the only thing standing in front of you is yourself and putting in some hard work. So remember from the first video in this series, the 20-hour rule. So go ahead, use these tips to find a learning resource, judge if it's the right one for you, and pencil in 20 one-hour sessions into your calendar. Before you know it, you'll get the ball rolling, you'll start making progress, and things will start looking very, very positive. Now, in the next step in this series of how to become an iOS developer, I'm going to tell you how you can judge when you are ready to start applying for jobs, building your own app, and what are the steps that you can prepare to ensure success. All right, thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video.